I want to welcome Troy Aikman, the man of the hour, too sweet to be sour, the tower of football power. Troy, great to see you again.
Yeah,
man.
Good to see you.
Troy, I've known you like since the Korean War.
Been a long time.
Yes.
It's been a long time.
Yes. Troy, when did you know as a kid, like, dang, I'm an awesome athlete? I mean, not that you know, because you're a very humble guy, but I mean, when did you know, like, man, I'm pretty good?
You know, I picked it up pretty quickly, you know? I mean, right from the very beginning. I started playing organized sports when I was about 7 years old, and it just kind of came naturally for me. I worked at it, but it also was very natural. And so I had good hand-eye coordination. I wasn't the fastest guy, but I had relatively good quickness, you know, at that age. And, you know, I could shoot a basketball and
yeah,
pretty
and
much
see, I was blown away. I was playing basketball with this guy. And I was like, I cannot believe how good a basketball player you were. You are, Troy.
Well, I was.
You remember that game we played back in the day? You don't remember
yeah,
that.
I do.
You do.
I was a good shooter.
You're better, Troy. You're being humble, man. Yeah, you were rebounding, passing, shooting, defense.
I was one of the, you know, and I probably enjoyed basketball more than the other sports that
really?
I played. Well, because it was the one that I was the least good at, but even though I was decent, and I also knew it was the one that I wasn't going to try to further. I knew I was not going to go on and play college basketball.
Yes.
So I tended then to not put as much pressure on myself when I was growing up playing basketball, and probably had more fun as a result of that, playing it.
You were an amazing parent. I mean, I know you, obviously, I know people that know you, et cetera. I was recently just on your Twitter feed looking. You're serious about parenting.
Yeah.
What did you learn from a quarterback that you translate and transfer to your kids?
Well, it's a really good question. You know, interestingly enough, I think about that a lot. I mean, I think about, I guess, kind of what motivated me as an athlete, and then how does that then translate as to how I raise my kids, right? And I try not to overdo it, but we had this conversation, my oldest daughter and I would take them on these walks. And we were walking along, this was a couple summers ago, and I was in one of those moods where I was lecturing them, and Jordan, my oldest, who's now 14, she had been going to lacrosse, and she was told to practice so much during the evenings and, you know, on their own, and she hadn't done it. And so I said, yeah, and you hadn't even practiced the lacrosse like your coach told you to, and I'm walking along, and all of a sudden, I don't feel any footsteps behind me any longer, right? So I stop, and I kind of turn around, and both of my girls had just stopped, and and Jordan, I walk back, and Jordan says, Dad, I'm not going to be a professional athlete. You need to know that.
Wow.
And it really was kind of a punch in the stomach to me, and I bent down and I said, darling, I said, I don't think you're going to be a professional athlete, but you're going to be something. You're going to be something in life. I mean, I don't know what that is, and you may not even know yet what it is, but you're going to go to college, you're going to get an education, you're going to be a teacher, you're going to be a doctor, you're going to be, you know, whatever it is. But whatever that thing is that you become, you want to be good at it. And to be good at it, you have to work at it. And so that was a little bit of my athletic background and just trying to explain to them. And I tried to impress upon both of my girls that, you know, if you're going to be good at anything and if something's important to you, you have to invest the time. And I think that as athletes, we certainly learn that.
I remember I interviewed you at our church back in the day. You remember that?
I sure did.
Okay. And I remember after the interview, people were like, man, can you see Troy? Can you believe Troy good he is? And I told people, like, well, it doesn't really surprise me in a way. But how have you done that? Because you, from all-world football, all-world announcer.
I work at it just like I did when I was playing. You know what I mean?
Oh, I know.
You can't fake it, right?
No.
So I think you got to put in the time. And I just try to be as prepared as I can be and be honest and yet respectful of the guys that are there doing it. Because, you know, I know that when I played, it's not an easy game. And I don't want to be the armchair quarterback who's constantly saying, well, you know, you got to do this. You know, yeah, I got to point those things out. But at the same time, it's hard.
Yes, it is.
So I try to point out maybe, especially with quarterback play, why a quarterback threw that interception or why he did this instead of this and shed a little light on that. And then at the same time, try to be honest about it.
Have you, I know you've worked your rear off, but has anyone worked with you in speaking?
No, I've never had any formal coaching.
I'm serious.
In the business. I think that the one thing that we get away with as analysts, whereas a play-by-play guy, like my partner is Joe Buck.
Yes, I know.
So,
yeah, I don't know Joe.
You know, he was an English major or whatever it was. Yeah. And, you know, they get critiqued on a little different scale.
Yes.
You know, I mean, we come into it with a very low bar. right? As an athlete, we come in, nobody thinks
it's
we
pretty
can
low.
Speak.
That's
I mean,
right.
In fact,
he
you're
can
going,
speak.
I mean, you're saying right now, wow, but you can actually talk. I mean, how did you do that?
Yeah, I got
you
it. Know, I got
so,
it. Yeah.
You know, so we get a little bit more leeway than some of the others in our business.
Do they ever like say, Troy, you say this phrase too much?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, tell me the phrases.
The one phrase, Joe would say something, and my response to that very early on was always, you know, you're absolutely right. And then, boom, I'd go on and say what I say. And then finally, my producer said, you don't have to say it. Just say what you're going to say. And you know,
that's
but
good.
There are little things that you find yourself saying, and you've got to either you have to pick it up when you go back and you watch the tape, or you're hopeful that you do have a producer or a friend at home or somebody that can be you know, critically honest and say, hey, look, this doesn't work. And fortunately, I've got people that are not afraid to tell me what doesn't work. So
well, see, we have a critique meeting after every service where they kind of rip apart, not in a mean way, everything from worship we're doing, video, and the message. And, you know, my kids have, like, top 10 dad's phrases that are worn out. So the kids help me a lot, too, and also the people just around me. Like, man, Ed, you're wearing that out. So, Troy, as a quarterback, going back to your Cowboy days, you look at defenses. Tell me what you have to do in a split second, like to pull off the play. I mean, I know you will sometimes change the play. Talk to us about that, some of the armchair experts.
Yeah, I think, you know, you get the play in from the sideline, you make the call, and as you're making the call, you're kind of envisioning the or I did anyway, the play unfolding in your head as to what you expect. And you're walking to the line, and with a pass play, for instance, you anticipate, okay, where am I protected, where am I not protected? Mm-hmm. Because every pass play has a protection, and not all of them are max protection. So there's always some vulnerabilities in that. And you have to, first of all, know whether or not you have enough protection to block all the guys that will be rushing. After that, then you go to the safeties and see what's happening with them at the snap of the ball. And they try to disguise, but the safeties will determine what the coverage is. So off of that, then you know immediately where you're going to go with the football, at least on your first read. And then you determine whether or not the guy's open. If he is, bang. If he's not, you get to the second guy, third guy. All that within, you know, obviously a short amount of time and with the added element of a pass rush, you know, that you're trying to maybe, you know, while you're looking downfield, avoid this guy, you kind of feel things. You know, so it's not always, I think in our game that people evaluate quarterbacks and they immediately think that, okay, well, the biggest, the strongest, the biggest arm, you know, the fast guy that can make people miss and run. All those things are great, but there's so many other elements to be great at this game as a quarterback, and a lot of it is really being able to process information and make good decisions under duress. And I think that's the important thing for any quarterback.
Okay, listen, when people, if I go to a game, I remember back in the day, you know, people would criticize you. Anytime you do anything, as you know, people criticize. I heard you say this one time. You said, Ed, whatever someone is thinking in the stands or even in the media, he said, we've thought about it thousands of times already. That's a brilliant line. What do you tell people, leaders, others, about criticism?
Well, it's an interesting question because we're at a different time now because everyone has a platform to express the criticism. So if you want to see criticism, you know, do a Twitter search on any broadcaster's name, mine included, during the actual broadcast. I mean, you know, and if you go back and you search your name, and you see what a lot of people are talking about, and it's not favorable. People just don't say positive things. I think, you know, what I get from it is I know when I hear critics, if there's some validity to what they're saying, and say, I respect that person. And I think there is some truth to maybe what they're saying. And to me, then that's very constructive.
Yes.
You know, the other side of it, if it's criticism with just some, you know, there's a lot of, you know, mean-spirited, hateful, you know, people, and you just try to put that in its proper category as well. And I don't know, I think we're at a time, especially for young kids, it's hard. Man. It's really hard. I mean, I got my girls, and they're on the Snapchat and you know, Instagram and, you know, all that kind of stuff. And you know, occasionally they'll run into me and say, hey, Dad, look at this, and they'll have their feelings hurt, and we got to sit and talk about it. But I don't know that I have a great answer for it, other than just really, I guess, trying to evaluate where exactly the mm-hmm. criticism's coming from. Because sometimes you can learn a lot from it yes. if it's coming from the right people.
Yeah, the right people, and they have the right tenor and tone. Right. Sometimes I tell young people, it's like, I don't know, it's like social media is a sports center living, highlight reel living. It's not really
right.
the real thing. So I think it's important who you listen to, good, bad, or ugly.
Well, and I think the other thing, too, is that all of us, I'm on social media. You know, I'm on Facebook.
Twitter
and all that. And we all share our best moments.
Yes, we do.
Our most favorable moments of our day or our week or uh-huh. our life. And I guess as we should. But I think sometimes, and that's really the crux of it all, and people are trying to sift through it, that, you know, life's hard. I mean, I got a great
life.
Yes, it is. You've got a great life. You know, the life is great,
yes.
but it doesn't mean there's not tough moments for all of us. And and sometimes you lose sight of that if you're a young person finding your way.
Yes.
And you just think that, gosh, this person's never had a difficult day right. in their life. And I just think, that especially in a day when celebrity is really important, mm-hmm. I think to a lot of our youth, they look up at the people who are, I don't even know who the relevant celebrities are for these kids anymore, but whoever they are, they didn't get there without a lot of trials and a lot of tough times. And it's like what you're saying, that snapshot of them or what you see of them on stage, that really isn't their life. I mean, they've been through a lot mm-hmm. and not all of it real positive. And so I think kids need to understand that and know that they're going to have difficult times themselves. I think it's important. I tell my girls all the time, it's important to surround yourself with
yes.
good people, you know? And even for me, I mean, I got to a point many years ago, this just didn't happen, but many yep. years ago, I just finally said, you know what? I just want to be around people that inspire me in some way. You
that
know,
is
don't
the
just
truth.
Pull me down. And I think I've been able to do that. And fortunately, a lot of those longtime friends that I've had, they do inspire me. So
yep.
they've gotten to hang around for a while.
You know, I heard someone say, Troy, and I've tried to live by this, I remember I would go to certain places or whatever, and I thought, all right, people sort of like me okay, but they more tolerate me. And somebody goes, Ed, don't go where you're tolerated, go where you're celebrated. And I don't mean like, well, you're great, but I mean like, you know, they,
yeah.
and once I made that decision, I think about a decade ago, it really helped me because, I don't know, I think in everyone's life, you have those relational challenges, and you gotta move toward the right people in your life, and when you do that, not that you're dissing people, but you
right.
gotta, you know. Troy, I got something else I gotta share with you. We're almost done. Troy, I wrote this play out on a napkin. And in my opinion, Troy, even though you're Hall of Fame, whatever, I think you were even underrated. I think you were one of the best quarterbacks ever. But Troy, I think if you'd have run this play about two or three times a game, I think you'd have had a longer career.
Yeah.
What do you think?
I like it.
Yeah. See, and Troy, look, I even drew it out. See, I did draw it out for Romo, but I took him, I put number 8. What do you think about that? If, like, you drop back, Statue of Liberty, maybe like Michael Irvin, whatever, would he come that way? Where would he be?
That's old school.
What
Irvin would have been over here.
Okay.
Yeah, and he would have then come back around. I don't know if we'd have fooled anybody, but it would have looked good.
Yeah, but Troy, so the Statue of Liberty. So you're saying it would change your career, aren't you? Right, you're saying.
Well, you are.
Done this,
yeah, you are. I'll go along with
okay.
it.
So the Statue of Liberty is this. You go back, right, and like you're passing and they take it from you, like, or do you hand it off behind you? How do you
no,
do it?
No, well, I've never actually seen it run, but I guess, you know, you act like you're passing
okay.
and they come running by and take it off your hand.
I used to do that like in touch football, flag football.
How'd it work?
Oh, it was incredible. Incredible.
Well, I'll pass it on to Jason Garrett. We'll see if maybe they'll run.
Yeah, you do that. You know? That would be excellent, Troy. Troy, can you imitate Jerry Jones very well? I can, okay.
You can?
How's it sound?
I tell you, the best quarterback we've ever had is Troy Aikman's. Aikman's.
Is that pretty good?
Pretty good. Yeah.
Okay, I gotta show Troy, though. Okay, Troy, I've been doing this, okay? I made this up. Okay, I call this the hug-illusion. You know, I was back in the day, give me 5, whatever, blah, blah, blah. Well, now, you know, all the cool people, you know, it's all this. What's up, man? You know, but that's all right.
Yeah.
But I invented this, and I've shared this with a couple people.
It's called the Hugolution. And you, powerful guy, strong guy, Troy, a lot of stress. Here we go, watch this. You go here, watch it, boom, and you just boom, on the shoulder. Let me tell you what that does. Gives you a nanosecond of rest during the day.
Yeah.
What do you think? What? Boom, 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 that's it. Like maybe it. You and Joe Buck or whoever.
Hey.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How you like it?
It's not bad. It's not bad. You just have to explain it before you do it each time.
I have a confession to make. I was watching the Cowboys game last Sunday evening. I was very, very tired. Lisa and I have been to Virginia and we did a relationship seminar and I spoke several times here, so I was like really worn out. Watching the game, it's in our bedroom. The Giants are on the Cowboys' 1 yard line with a minute 47 to go. I turned to Lisa and I said, honey, turn the game off. I can't bear to watch. I went to bed. The next thing I remember, Lisa woke me. It was like 6:30 a.m. She goes, honey, you won't believe it. The Cowboys came back and won. They won the game. What a horrible example of a Cowboy fan. Absolutely horrendous. What is a fan? Are you a fan? What is a fan? A fan is an enthusiastic follower. As you look at the life of Jesus, he challenged a lot of people to do a lot of following. He challenged children, he challenged singles, he challenged married adults, he challenged the rich, the poor, he challenged the depressed, he challenged the impressed, he challenged all sorts of people to follow him. He said, come and follow me, over and over and over. If Jesus were right here on this stage, he might just say, become a fan, become an enthusiastic follower of me. Because the word fan is an enthusiastic follower. We're fans. Have you ever wondered why we're fans? Have you ever thought about that? No one ever taught me how to become a fan. I just am a fan. When a touchdown is scored, yeah! No one taught me how to do that. When something good happens, whoa, yeah. No one taught me that. I just know how to do it. A fan is intrinsic. It's something inside of us. It's something that we are. We're fans, aren't we? We're fans. We're enthusiastic followers. We're fans of golf. A lot of people, I mean, you're a true follower of golf. Others here, maybe you follow tennis. You're an enthusiastic follower of tennis. It could be triathletes. Triathlons, it could be marathons, it could be fishing, that's a biblical sport. It could be hunting, it could be, yeah, thank you. It could be fashion, it could be anything, it could be horses. People follow, people are a fan of certain things. I believe, and if you think about it, I believe that in the depth of our being, God has placed this desire there to be a fan. It's a God thing. So often though, we're so devoted to certain things that we can, if we're not careful, waste our worship. We can, if we're not careful, decaffeinate our devotion. Obviously, we're to enjoy things. The Bible says that. We're to enjoy different things and chase after different things. However, we should become an enthusiastic follower. That's God's design. We should become an enthusiastic follower of Jesus. We're hardwired for that. Think back in your mind. Think back to the first time you ever recognized a fan. I think the first time I ever recognized someone who was a fan, or maybe they were trying to be a fan, was when my parents would drag me to see the University of South Carolina play back in the day. I was like maybe in the fourth grade. I remember sitting there in that stadium. There was a guy behind us, and whenever the South Carolina Gamecocks would make a mistake, this guy would do this. Boo! Scared me to death. He would drink out of his flask. Boo! It got worse and worse. I was fearful to go to the games because of this so-called fan. He definitely was a fair weather fan. And we have a lot of fair weather fans here. That's just the way it is. But if you're a true fan, you don't go from the Cowboys to the Giants, from the Giants to the Philadelphia Eagles, from the Eagles to the Miami Dolphins. No, no, no. You are a fan. You are full on. Sometimes you're watching football and the announcer will make this ubiquitous statement. Someone will do something really great. Oh, you can't teach that. You can't teach it. You can't teach it. You can't teach it. Oh, you can't teach that. What's the announcer saying? You're just born with it. When it comes to being a fan, you can't teach it. So I want to challenge you to think about becoming a fan. I want to challenge you to see if indeed you are a fan, an enthusiastic follower of the Lord, because I would argue you're made to be a fan. In other words, God's plan for man is to be a
fan.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about some facets of being a fan. Four facets of being a fan. Do you have your message map with you? Make sure to, I can't believe you don't have the message map out at all of our campuses. Dallas, Fort Worth, wherever you are, Miami. Okay, we're gonna fill in the blanks because whenever you see a blank, blanks are like, fill me in, please fill me in. Don't leave me blank, fill me in. Are you ready to fill it in? Number one, here's what it means to be a true fan. Real fans, are you a real fan? Real fans are emotional. They're emotional. I think about Florida State. Back in the day, I had the opportunity to play basketball at Florida State. I spent most of my career on the bench, but I did start several games. You can look it up. My lifetime average, I think, was 0.7 per game. Anyway, whenever I would hear the Florida State fight song, something would happen to me. It's the best fight song out there. No other school can compete with that fight song. You know it. Yeah, okay. And sometimes I have to confess, if I'm like in a bad mood or maybe I don't want to speak, I'll just crank that fight song up in my office, run down the tunnel, and I'm ready. I saw some of the Florida State fans, and I've been there. Those fight songs do something, don't they? Whoa! They create emotion. Do you realize already we've played some fight songs in this stadium? You might call them worship songs. They're fight songs. Because remember, we're fighting a battle. Remember, we're pushing the ball upfield. Remember, we're playing offense. Remember, we're studying the strategy of the enemy. Remember, we are warriors. Remember, we're not fighting for victory, we're fighting from victory. So we should get into fight songs. And it blows me away how people will go to AT&T Stadium, lose their absolute mind, dancing, singing, painting your face, spending squillions of dollars on parking and overpriced junk food and adult beverages, sitting in a crammed stadium watching a bunch of genetic freaks push a pigskin with air in it up and down a green field. And then you walk into church. Man, the church is so loud. I'm not sure about it. I don't know about these songs. I didn't grow up that way, and I don't know. It's kind of entertaining a little bit, and I'm not sure. I just want to go to a half-empty church and a half-empty parking lot and hear a sermon that's half empty. No. Sorry. That's not what the Bible says. We're emotional creatures. God has feelings too. He gave us emotion. And the Bible says in Psalm 47, verse 1, oh, clap. Clap your hands, all you peoples. Shout to God with the voice of victory. V-I-C-T-O-R-Y, victory, victory. That's our cry. V-I-C-T-O-R-Y, V-I-C-T-O-R-Y. Heaven is not going to be this quiet place. It's not going to be a stained glass fortress with organ music. That's not going to be it. I mean, there'll be some times in heaven where it's silent, but I'm telling you, it's going to be loud. Billions of people. It's not going to be a small place. We're going to have worship. We're going to have music. Is this going to be a sight? So we have to understand something. We're made to express stuff. We're made to worship God with emotion. We're made to be enthusiastic followers of God. Enthusiasm. You know what the word means, enthusiasm? In the original language, in theos, in God. So if I'm in God, I'm going to be enthusiastic. Are you an enthusiastic follower? If you are, you're emotional. You're emotional. Notice, too, the second thing. Real fans not only are emotional, they're faithful. They're faithful. They're like devoted. The Bible says, commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him, and he will do this. I consider myself a real, full-on cowboy fan in the 90s. And the reason was my friendship with Troy Aikman, to drop names, hashtag humbled, because, you know, I've known Troy for a long, long time. He's attended our church for a long, long time, and he's been to my house, and we've shared meals, and blah, 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 blah. Well, once that happened, I didn't just know about the quarterback of the Cowboys. Now, all of a sudden, I know personally the quarterback of the Dallas Cowboys, and everything changed. People come to church. Oh, man, I'm cool with Jesus. I know about the Lord. But do you know him? Do you know him intimately? Because if you know him, it's a game changer. If you know him, you are an enthusiastic follower of the Lord. If you know him, you talk to him, you listen to him. Think about it. If you were a true fan of the Cowboys, would you say, you know, I just watch the Cowboys play once a month. I don't care about the rest of their games. I mean, I'll just maybe once a month if I can. It'll shock you to see how many professing or pseudo fans across our nation only attend church once a month. Once a month. It's stunning when you think about it, because if you love the quarterback, Jesus, you're gonna love his team, and you're gonna love his house. It's that simple. If you don't, then I would put a big question mark. Are you really a fan, or maybe a boo, a fair weather fan? I don't know. So real fans are emotional. Real fans are faithful. The third facet of a fan, real fans are informational. Is that the truth? They're informational. Philippians 1:9. I pray, the Apostle Paul writes, that your love will overflow more and more, and that you'll keep on growing in knowledge and understanding. Very simple. I've been married to Lisa for 33 years. I've known her 39 years. The more time I spend with her, my love and our love grows. The more knowledge I have of her, the more understanding I have of her, the more you have togetherness and oneness. Same is true with the Lord. The same is true with him. I'm amazed at how often so many of us know all the stats and the figures of all of the sports teams, the fantasy football, the data that really doesn't matter. We know so much. I mean, we know the names of the pets of our favorite players, and we know their vertical jump and how many times they can bench press 225 pounds and where they went to grammar school, and we all know all these stats and talk radio, and we can't get enough. More information, and we're online now. Oh my gosh, this is incredible. More, even more information, more information. That's cool. It's great to have a hobby. But so often, I'll ask someone, really? That's great, all the stats. Who are the minor prophets? How many books are there in the Old Testament? Clueless. So are you putting in your brains data that doesn't really matter, or the data that matters? And this is the data that matters. It's great. It's wonderful. Rah, 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 go team, go, to understand information. But the Bible was not written for our information. It's not a textbook. The Bible was written for our transformation. It's written for our application. So we don't stay in the huddle all day long. I mean, I don't go see a football game to watch a huddle, bunch of big old butts. No, no, I don't do that. I watch football to watch them break from the huddle and play the game. So the church is not a holy huddle. No, 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 no. It's great to huddle up and listen to the play, then we break and we do it. Notice the fourth facet of the fan. Are you a real fan? Really, it's a question only you can answer for yourself. Real fans are promotional. They're promotional. The other night, I went out to eat at Papacito's with family, and we had some friends from Indiana in town, pastor and some other people. We went out with some staff members as well. Papacito's, man, that's a good place. Have you ever been to Papacito's? Yeah, it's a great place. I know those of you in Miami are like, Papa, what? Have you ever, I'm telling you, I like Papacito's. I do, I like it. It's good. Well, we're there eating Papacito's with all these people. In fact, I'll tell you who was with us, Eric Thede. Eric, come out, Eric. Do you guys know Eric? Eric, come out, Eric. There he is. Okay, Eric was with us with his party and his lovely wife, Bree, and Bree's brother, and all these people. So we're sitting there, and this happens sometimes. This guy is working at Papacito's. Is like, Ed, man, what's up? I go, I'm great. So when he greets me, guess what? Hugolution, this guy works at Papacito's that quick. He goes, how are you doing? I go, I'm doing great. How's the food? I said, it's great. Then he looks over to Eric and goes, white chocolate. That's his nickname. This guy has as much soul as Kanye right here. No, no, he doesn't. Listen, let me hear some soul right quick. You don't mind a little bit of soul. Amen. So, we had a great time, Eric, and this guy's name was Terrence. Yep. He's a cool guy.
He was a very cool guy.
And he shows me, he goes, look at my phone. So I look at his iPhone, and he's in the process of inviting his friend to quarterback. Yeah. That guy's promotional.
He was super excited. He was super excited about it. Couldn't wait to get him here.
He's probably here today. I don't know where. He's somewhere, one of our campuses. Eric Thede, white chocolate. White chocolate. The Bible says in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, check this out, you'll receive power. Power. You know what the word power is in the original? Dunamis. We get the word dynamite from it. This is going to date me. I mean, it's going to show how old I am. I don't care. I'm 54. Sue me. You remember the show Good Times with Jimmy Walker? Dynamite! Okay, yeah, this is that verse. Every time I read this verse, I think about Jimmy Walker. Dynamite! because that's what it is. You will receive dynamite, the Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you'll be my witnesses. What's a witness? Somebody that tells the truth about what they've seen and heard. Something that's happened to them. I always challenge people. Hey, people, you pray this prayer every day and all heaven and then all hell will break loose in your life. Say this, Lord, open doors for me to promote and for me to glorify you and give me the boldness to do that. I promise you that'll happen. Are you bold enough to do it? Are you a fan enough to do that? Because a real fan, I mean, you see them around the office when they're drinking out of their tumbler, drinking the, you know, coffee, it'll have Dallas Cowboys. And the real fans, you go into their closet. I don't recommend like checking people's closets out, but you'll see all these jerseys. You go to their home, they'll have a man cave or a woman cave. You see them drive around on the weekends, you'll have the flags of the Cowboys or maybe the Dolphins or whatever. That's a real fan. So we have no shame in our game. We will promote who we like. Yet when it comes to the things of God, now, I'm not saying we take the ball and jam it down people's throats. You know me. You know our church. I am saying, though, pray the prayer. God will open up opportunities. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 10, verse 32, therefore, whoever confesses me, promotes me, Jesus said, before men, then I will also promote them before my Father who is in heaven. How cool is that? It's about promotion. I love the fact that we can promote as a church. When I see these billboards around, man, thank the Lord that we can promote. We have the best message in the universe. When I listen to the ticket and I hear a commercial, boom, we can promote. When we text people every weekend and call you, we can promote. So we have the best thing in the world to promote. It's the person of Jesus. Jerry Jones. Jerry, you know Jerry came to Fellowship Church years ago? That's another story. I interviewed him. It's a long story, but it was very, very, very fun. I've tried to get Jerry for this series. If you know him, tell him he needs to allow us to interview him. We've tried, but
we can't do it.
Anyway, Jerry Jones is a promoter. And I thought about this the other day. What would Jerry Jones say? Then I thought, what would Jerry Jones not say? Here's some things you will not hear Jerry Jones say. This is kind of extra credit. You can jot this down too. You want to hear this? And I'll try to imitate him a little bit. I can tell you want me to. Here's what Jerry Jones will not say. Number one,
my stadium is too big.
He didn't say stadium,
stadium.
You not hear Jerry Jones say that? Oh, it's just too big. We can rent, jam 100,000 people in there. It's too big. Yet I hear people say that about Fellowship. Oh, it's just too big. The other day I was at gym where I work out, and I saw this guy, and he was like, man, I'm going to come by Fellowship Church. I said, I want you to. I said, we're doing this series called Quarterback. He goes, cool. He goes, man, the more I think about it, I don't know, that place is huge, man. I don't know. I said, yeah, heaven's going to be big. I mean, God is a big God. If you're around a lot of people, your church is going to be big. I've never heard someone say, oh, man, got these four seats, 50-yard line, see the Cowboys play, but I'm not going because the stadium's too big. I'm just not going to go. I'm not going. I'm not going to the gallery anymore. It's just too big. Is that hilarious? It's really funny, isn't it? Big, big. Well, you know, Jerry Jones is not going to say that. Jerry Jones will also never say this. This is funny.
It's just too loud in here.
No. That place can get loud. You go to a sporting event, it's going to be loud. I mean, really loud. Yeah, sometimes people have the audacity to say, oh, the church is just too loud. If you guys could just somehow turn the volume down a little bit. It's just my ears and I can't understand the words. And I understand sometimes. But heaven, as I said earlier, is gonna be loud. What's wrong with being loud? God made us to be loud. And also God made us to be quiet. So if you have a problem with loud, come on now. Come on now, you're not thinking right. You go scream your head off and sing and dance. Oh, 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 come to church. I love you, Lord. Here, Jerry Jones will never say this.
The whole cowboy experience is too entertaining. It's too entertaining.
I sometimes have heard that. People are like, man, I feel like Fellowship Church sometimes is just entertaining. I go, thank you. We're all about entertainment. You mean we allowed the devil to steal entertainment from us? You mean to tell me you should not be entertained at church? What are you smoking? Have you read your Bible? That's gotta be one of the dumbest statements anybody can ever make. What did Jesus do? People were sitting on the edge of their seats. What did Jesus do? He entertained entertainment to capture and hold someone's attention for an extended period of time. That is what is all about the Bible. We got to rethink church. We got to rethink this thing. Come on, somebody. Here's another one. This is my favorite. Last one. It's going to be funny. You got to laugh at yourself. Jerry Jones will never say this.
I just want your money.
Now, we spend all this money, who knows how much if we're a real fan, and yet we never say, man, the Cowboys just want my money. That's what he wants. Hello? Multi-billionaire. Then we come to church.
Oh, man, the church just wants my money. He's talking about the money. That's all they want. The church just wants my money. The church wants my money. I can't believe it. I'm not going back again. The church just wants my money. And I can't believe it. They want my money. And they want my money. And I'm not going to pay my money. I want to pay somebody.
You were spending money for something temporal. Cowboys win. Ah! That's it. We bring our money here to this house, to God, whether it's here or wherever you attend church, wherever you're a member, and the experience of winning is not temporal, it's eternal. It's eternal. So I want you to watch this. See, go through your outline again. Jesus is emotional. We have feelings. Jesus is faithful to you and me, committed, so committed. He endured the cross because of your sins and mine. He's informational. He knows you and me better than we know ourselves. He is promotional. The Bible says right now, Jesus is promoting you and me to the Father. Even prayers I can't even articulate, Jesus is taking those to the Father. Is that great news? So what do you need to do? You need to become a fan. Do you know Jesus? I don't mean know about him. Do you know him? You can know him. Some of you here need to join Fellowship Church. What if I said, hey, I play in the NFL? Your next question, what team? Oh no, man, I just play in the NFL. Every team has a roster. And if you're not a part of a local team, you're turning your back on the only thing that Jesus ever built. So it's time for you to join the church. And right after this service, after I say amen, we're gonna have an opportunity here and at all of our campuses to join Fellowship Church. Go to this newcomers class. You don't have to join when you go to the class, but we'll tell you what Fellowship Church is all about because there's a place, there's a position for you on this on this field. We want you to play. We want you to be an enthusiastic follower of Jesus. So do you know Jesus? How do you know Jesus, Ed? Well, here's how you become a fan, a true fan. You have to admit your wrongdoings, your turnovers, your penalties to him. You have to turn from that, turn to the Lord and say, Jesus, take control of my life. You run the show, you call the plays, you be my quarterback, from this day forward. And once you make that decision, I'm telling you, this place is the place where you can grow and discover who you are. Quarterback. Who's your quarterback? A fan. Are you an enthusiastic follower of the Lord? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for this day. We thank you for this great church. And we thank you for giving us the opportunity to push the ball downfield. We ask all these things in Jesus' name and for his sake alone. Amen.